In March 2022, Apple added a brand new line of Macs to its lineup, the Mac Studio. Looks kind of like a tall Mac Mini or maybe a junior Mac Pro, but is it? It's neither. Let's dig in. Hey, make sure to watch this video all the way through. I've got a little bonus surprise at the end with an unusual perspective you might not have thought of. I've previously done three different videos detailing Apple's transition over from the Intel line to the Apple Silicon line of chips. At this point of the transition where we stand today, Apple has transitioned most of its Mac product line over to Apple Silicon. By and large, this has been a very, very successful transition with benefits for users and developers alike. Eyeballing it, I'd say about 75% of third-party developers have now successfully ported over to Apple Silicon. Though there are some notable holdouts, like Avid's Pro Tools and Vienna Ensemble Pro. Most of the other major players, including Motu, Apple's Logic, Cubase, Ableton, and many plugin manufacturers, have successfully made the jump over. The last thing I'll say on the topic of transitioning from Intel to Apple Silicon is that if you're still on an Intel-based platform and you would like to make the jump to an Apple Silicon Mac, you'll need to do a complete tally of all the hardware and software manufacturers that you rely on specifically for your setup and make sure that each of those developers are Apple Silicon ready. Some manufacturers might label it as M1 ready because the M1 is the Apple Silicon chip that Apple is currently developing. I'll leave a link or two down below with some very helpful lists that people have made of manufacturers that are or aren't Apple Silicon ready. So now, let's turn to the brand new Mac Studio. Apple is specifically pitching this machine at us creatives, and it comes in two main configurations, the 10-core M1 Max and the 20-core M1 Ultra, which is basically two M1 Max chips fused together. Will this literally mean double the processing power? It's hard to say until we get some real-world benchmarks. But because of the way audio software has long been designed to use multiple cores, the answer is probably yes. These new machines are really beautiful. They do look a bit like an enlarged Mac Mini. On the front, you have a card reader and either USB 4 or Thunderbolt 4 ports, depending on which model you get. On the back, you get four Thunderbolt 4 ports, 10 gigabytes per second Ethernet, power, two USB-A ports, HDMI, and a headphone jack. Right off the bat, this is a really nice configuration of I/O for us musicians. And even though many of us still have to invest in a Thunderbolt or USB hub, this is a machine that is capable of running a high-end music studio. So let's talk about this a little bit. How ideal is this machine for a musician studio? Comparing it to an Intel Mac Pro or an Intel iMac, Apple is projecting some pretty impressive speeds that make its own machine seem paltry by comparison. Here's the top-of-the-line Intel iMac compared to the M1 Max Mac Studio. Here's the top-of-the-line Intel Mac Pro compared to the M1 Ultra Mac Studio. Here's a comparison of GPU performance. Now, although I'll always caution that Apple's own benchmarks and PR are designed to paint their machines in the best possible light and utilize numerous subliminal techniques to encourage us to be inspired and eventually to purchase them, these are still really impressive, at least approximate margins, even if they haven't been verified by third parties yet. Now here's a fascinating little sidebar. A couple of years ago, Apple released the last Intel Mac Pro, their highest end machine, and the prices shocked some people, with one running joke being you could either buy a Tesla or the high-end new Mac Pro. Take a look at the price of a fully decked out Intel Mac Pro and compare it to the price of the just announced Mac Studio, also fully decked out. If I was choosing my next machine and money was no object at all, I would actually still choose this new Mac Studio. It is the next-gen platform as opposed to the previous-gen platform. Not every user needs a top-of-the-line Mac Studio. Here, let me walk you through a virtual shopping trip where I'll configure a Mac Studio and explain each of the options as I see them. The first and most expensive choice that you face is whether to opt for the 10-core M1 Max version or the 20-core M1 Ultra version. This, unfortunately, is a place where it just comes down to money. The machine on the left is extremely powerful, and I would still call it a high-end Mac. The machine on the right is the fastest machine that Apple makes. And if you are one who is constantly pushing the boundaries of how many plugins you need to use simultaneously, or you use massive amounts of sample libraries and want to be able to keep them on one computer, you may want to consider the computer on the right. I'm going to go ahead and configure that one for this video. You now get the option of a GPU upgrade. At a $1,000 price tag, in my opinion, this is not something that's crucial for musicians. This is something that would really pay off for video editors or other people who make extreme demands on GPUs. So I'm going to leave that option off. Next, how much RAM do we need? 64 gigs of unified memory is a nice, healthy, and even extravagant amount for most users. The only people who may want to consider the 128GB option for an additional $800 would be those who are using massive amounts of sample libraries and are hoping to load them on this one machine. If you're someone who's thinking about the 128GB version, you're likely someone who's fought this battle before and knows they need more. If you haven't crossed this threshold yet, where you're pushing your machine to the limits of its available memory, you might not need to consider that. The next user configurable option is for the amount of storage. Thankfully, Apple is not offering any of those super small drives anymore, and everybody gets at least 1TB. Me personally, I end up adding several external drives via Thunderbolt or USB 4, which contain my sample libraries, my projects, and other important files that I need at hand. As a result, I've been getting along with a 1TB boot drive just fine. If you need a little bit more space, 2TB works great. Or if you're determined to keep everything on that internal drive, you can pony up for that 8TB storage option. I'm personally pretty leery of that, though. Every hard drive is destined to fail at some point in its lifespan, and I mitigate some of that risk by spreading my data across several different drives. So on this one, I'm likely to go for the 1TB. Of course, Apple lets you add Logic or Final Cut if you don't already own them and you want to have them, though they're both easily purchased later for exactly the same price if you decide later that you want them, so it's not vital to add them now. This what's in the box section is pretty important. What do you get? You get the computer and you get a power cord. Apple doesn't even include a keyboard and a mouse with this machine. So let's click continue to get to the next page. Here Apple's pushing their brand new Apple Studio Display, which was also announced at the same time. This Studio Display is an absolutely amazing display at a premium price. If your intent is to save money, there are many, many cheaper quality displays out there. And if you just want everything Apple, then feel free to add this too. Thankfully, Apple now prompts you if you want to add AppleCare, its extended warranty plan. I generally do think AppleCare is a really good value. For the amount of money you're paying for the whole computer, it is nice to have that peace of mind that it can be fixed easily at any point. Apple's new Magic Keyboard is a little bit pricey, but it does have Touch ID in the corner, which is a nice bonus feature. Their Magic Mouse is their premium mouse, or you can substitute a Magic Trackpad if you prefer. My own personal opinion, I've had a lot of trouble with the Magic Trackpad, and I found it ergonomically problematic, as well as not as precise as using a laptop trackpad. So after trying the Magic Trackpad, I actually returned it. Then I use an Apple Magic Mouse, which is a wonderful mouse, which supports touch clicking and swiping in every direction, as well as gestures. The one unanswered question I have is what's going to happen to the Mac Pro line? It seems virtually certain that Apple will also migrate that to Apple Silicon by the end of 2022. But the Mac Studio that we were just looking at is a high-end machine. So it begs the question, what's Apple going to do with the Mac Pro? Well, we don't know yet. This Mac Studio really has all the ports and expandability that I can ever imagine needing over the next several years in a computer. The only speculation I have is that Apple could glue 4 or 8 or 16 of these M1 chips together and make some M1 Ultra Max XL supersized chip that would be multiple times faster. This is theoretically possible, but it will also multiply the power requirements and the heat problems, which will necessitate a much bigger case. So we'll keep our eyes on Apple for the future, but if they create something along those lines, I guarantee you they'll multiply the price too. So my conclusion, is this a good machine for use in a music studio? Yes, 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 an unequivocal yes, this is amazing. By all accounts, it looks like this is going to be a very significant leap forward, and it's quickly going to eclipse the previous generation of Intel Macs. This is the most excited I've personally been about Apple's Pro line in about a decade. Back in 2013, I saw significant problems with the way that Apple introduced their trashcan Mac Pro. That was still a good computer, but it actually revealed that Apple was remarkably tone deaf at reading the needs of their Pro users. By removing expandability and taking things away from the previous Mac Pro that their Pro users had come to rely on. And they replaced it with this sexy trashcan looking thing that was built using Intel chips that were a year old. So even with Apple's marketing spin, it wasn't a market leading computer. Even Apple issued a rare mea culpa, not quite saying they were wrong, but saying they had painted themselves into a thermal corner with a machine that couldn't grow. It took them like 5 years to admit that. By the time the next major revision came around in the 2019 Mac Pro, Apple fixed a lot of that, while at the same time saying they were going to transition to Apple Silicon while releasing this Mac Pro using an Intel chip. Still a really amazing computer, but the price tag of its high-end configurations was really reserved for a very specific high-end clientele. And that's why I'm particularly excited about this Mac Studio. It feels like Apple has fixed all those problems. Expandability is back, power is cutting edge and significantly higher than the previous generations, and the price is in line with what I would expect for a power user's machine. And that's why I'm ready to jump on one of these as soon as I can get one shipped to me. This Mac Studio machine looks like it's going to be a fantastic machine and should have a long, usable lifespan. I think Apple has just taken a big leap forward. It's a good time to upgrade from an Intel machine if you're considering that. So, those are my opinions. Before I leave you, I came across this one video on TikTok with somewhat of a different opinion, but I figured it was worth sharing with you. Here's engineer and producer Steve Diakoudis with his take on the new machine.
Have you checked out the new Macs?
Yeah, I'm not interested.
Excuse me?
Not interested.
Why not?
I like the older ones. I think they sound fatter, more vintage.
I'm sorry, say again, please.
I mean, with the aging, I find that they start sounding better as they get older.
I hope you enjoyed these thoughts. You can count on more coming, especially if you ring that subscribe bell and give it a thumbs up. Thanks for watching. I'll see you on the next one.